Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm honored to be joined today by my good friend, General Stanley McChrystal. He has a new book out that's called Leaders, Myth, and Reality. And so first, I just start with thank you for being here. Always good to see you, and thank you for your service.
Well, David, thanks for having me, and thanks, everybody, for coming today. I appreciate it.
You know, service has clearly been in your blood. Your father was a two-star general. You followed in his footsteps. You graduated from West Point in 1976, just after the Vietnam War ended. Really, really tough period in the Army's history. How did that moment shape your entry in the Army and kind of the development of your career and your decision to really make that your career?
Yeah, it's interesting. My father had been in Vietnam, and I applied to West Point and got accepted in 1972, which statistically speaking is the easiest year in the Academy's entire history to be accepted. So anyway, here I am.
Looks like you outperformed
everyone. But it was a funny time because I got there and there were conflicted feelings there. It's a little bit of an insular place, but the superintendent had just, the guy about a year before had just been removed for things related to the My Lai cover-up. Mm-hmm. And so West Point was going through this sort of identity crisis. And then when I got into the actual Army after I graduated 4 years later, we were still in this post-Vietnam sort of hangover. And so the Army was trying to figure out where we fit in society, how we professionalize ourselves. And that was also the time when the decision was made to go to a professional, all-volunteer
right.
Army. And you got great people in it, but the reality is it started to make it a smaller, more insular thing, and fewer Americans had the opportunity to do the kind of service that maybe it isn't fun in the moment, does affect you for the rest of your life. And so one of the things I really started thinking about was, what does it mean to serve, and what does it do to you and for you?
So, you know, you think about that time, and you know, you go to work and you go through your career, and you rose from a second lieutenant to the commander of all the American and coalition forces in Afghanistan. And so you think about when you started in your career, you know, you're put into a leadership post. You know, you come out of West Point, you're put into a leadership post, but it's a completely different kind of leadership.
Yeah.
To be responsible for something like that. Talk about the evolution of your own leadership.
Sure.
You know, from kind of the beginning in your first leadership assignment to a leadership assignment of that magnitude.
When you first go to your first unit, I went to the 82nd Airborne Division, and this was in 1977, very early 1977. And that was not a great time at the 82nd Airborne compared to its storied history. And I got this platoon of paratroopers, and they were wonderful people, but they were yahoos. I mean, when they would run out of beer money near the end of the month, they would take an electrical cord and they split it and they frayed the ends and they would stand in a circle, plug it in, and then complete the circuit and sort of recharge themselves. Yeah, it was extraordinary. They were from different backgrounds than most of the people in this room were. They had different. But what you realize is when it came down to getting things done, they were just the salt of the earth. They were just extraordinary people. And so they'd come in with black eyes and cuts from bar fights the night before, but then they would give water out of their canteen to the guy next to them. And so you start with that experience, and it's sort of pure leadership because you're looking them in the eye and they're trying to bullshit the LT, and you're trying not to be bullshitted. But you learn to love them. And then you get to many years later, and I'm a four-star, and you've got people that you're dealing with in the political world from all the different countries, and even senior military, and everybody's much more polished, much more articulate, and whatnot. But in many cases, they're trying to bullshit the general, you know? And so it's not just as simple. It's arguably as important or more important, but it doesn't have that purity that leadership at the very lowest levels.
Much more pure.
Has. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a good description. So let's turn to the book. Okay. And I know you're excited on your book, and the book, you focus on some mythology around some of history's most notable and notorious leaders, and then just some other leaders that I never would have really thought about as leaders. It's actually, as we were discussing, it's a pretty eclectic collection. One of the stories you start with is the famous scene of George Washington crossing the Delaware.
Absolutely. There's a picture, you've all seen copies of it, and there's a version of it in the White House. great big thing, and it's got a very small boat, and it's got a few guys rowing, and then it's got George Washington standing up with a sword on his side, kind of leaning forward in this boat crossing this ice-filled river at night. And you look at it and you go, wow, that looks like a leader. And then you look at it and you go, whoa, it's at night, tiny little rowboat, he's standing up in the ice, he's an idiot. And you notice none of his people are holding on to him to keep him in. They're thinking, if he's stupid enough, you know. The sad part about it is, for my whole life, I've been watching that picture and saying, well, okay, that's a leader. And we don't question sometimes the mythology of why we would picture a leader like that, because you step back, when we have a leader now, you expect him to be 10 feet tall. You expect him to have answered all the questions. You expect him to never get scared. And leaders start to expect that of themselves, or at least they try to create a persona that makes you believe that's them. And it's absolutely unrealistic. And so one of the mythologies we've gotten about leadership is we expect leaders to be something they cannot possibly be. And then we are frustrated when they don't live up to that, or they, you know, there are a lot of cases where they get duplicitous trying to convince them that you are. So as we started this book, we wanted to look at leadership in a more holistic way. And we went back to Plutarch, the first century Greek turned Roman historian who profiled 48 famous Greek and Roman leaders, the first biographies, and we studied his methodology, we studied the people that he did, and we came out with this conclusion that leadership is not what we think it is, and it never has been. We've always looked at it through these mythologically tinged lenses, and that causes us to look at it in the past incorrectly. More importantly, it causes us to look in the future incorrectly.
So you use that an example, and then you go on to General Robert E. Lee.
Yeah.
And so he was a West Point grad, and you know, I know that his leadership on the battlefield was something that you once admired. Last year, you decided to throw away a painting of Lee that your wife gave you
Right. Years
ago when you were first married. Talk about how your perspective of him changed, and kind of the decision process behind that.
Yeah, it's first important to know that I sort of grew up with Robert E. Lee. I grew up near his boyhood home. I went to Washington Lee High School. My brother went to Washington Lee University. Then when I went to West Point, you walk in Robert E. Lee's footsteps. He is a larger-than-life personality at West Point. I lived in Lee Barracks. And there are all these generals that are studied at West Point and admired, but he's different. He is separate. He is so revered that he's this figure to emulate, but you can never get close to Robert E. Lee because he's just too good. He went through 4 years at West Point and didn't get a single demerit. I did not do that. But then he went out and
we asked how many you got.
Many. But then he went out in the Army and spent 32 years in this career, 17 years before the Mexican War as he's a young engineer officer. Does great work, but then in the Mexican War, he distinguishes himself, even though he's a staff officer, as being the brightest rising star in the officer corps of the United States Army. General Winfield Scott, the overall commander, says he's the best officer in the field I've ever seen. Then he comes, and later he's the superintendent at West Point. So here's a guy who is just absolutely on the rise, and he is courteous, he is brilliant, he is courageous on the battlefield. He is charismatic. He's all the things that if you had a checklist of being a great leader, he's it. And so I grew up with the idea that here is the epitome of leadership. And then when he gets commanding forces in the Civil War, he ties the Army of the Potomac in knots, the northern part of the Army in the East. And he is just this larger-than-life figure on the battlefield. And then, of course, for the 150 years after his death, countless paintings, countless statues around the country, and you just sort of accept the fact that Robert E. Lee is just amazing. Well, my wife gave me this picture in 1977, and $25 framed, and I just cherished it because, one, she gave it to me, and it's my hero, and so I was happy to have it in the house because it was a reminder to me, but it was also a symbol to people who visited us that they'd see Lee on my wall and they go, oh, that's who he admires. That's really good. Then after Charlottesville, the spring of 2017, my wife Annie, who David knows, came and says, you got to get rid of the picture. And I said, I can't get rid of the picture. You gave it to me. And she goes, no, nope, try again. And I said, well, I can't. That's just Robert E. Lee. He's not a political guy. And she says, he may not be to you, but when people come to our house, there's a real danger. They're going to think he symbolizes that you believe in something you don't believe in, which is white supremacy. And I said, well, he wasn't that at all. And we had this ongoing discussion for about a month. And then at the end of a month on a Sunday morning, I concluded she was right. I took it off the wall. It was an emotional moment. Took it out back, threw it away. And then we started studying him more. I'd read about it my whole life, but we started studying so we could write him and include him in the book. And we spent a full year writing that profile, just thinking about it. And well, we came to the conclusion.
Full year on that one profile.
That's right. Wow. I mean, that was the most emotional part of the book for me because I was so invested in it. And it was fun. We had some young research guys and my co-authors in the audience here, Jay Mangone. We had countless discussions, and the young author said, he's a bad guy, he did this. And I said, no, he's Robert E. Lee. In the context of the moment, we all would have done the same. And then as I studied it more, I came to the conclusion, no, we wouldn't. What he does is he basically abrogates the decision. He says, I'll do whatever the state of Virginia decides to do. I'll just go with them. And so he allows voters of Virginia in a referendum to make the most important decision of his life. And they vote to secede. He goes to the South. He fights for the Confederacy and spends 4 years trying to destroy the nation that his role model, Robert E. or George Washington, had done so much to create. And I would argue he got it completely wrong because he did it. Not only that, but he did it for slavery. Ultimately, he did it for slavery. Now, does that mean I hate him? Does that mean I don't admire anything about it? No, not at all. There's much about Robert E. Lee that I would love to emulate. There's much about Robert E. Lee I admire, but he got it wrong. And what that makes him to me is human. That makes him flawed, just like me, just like all of us.
Well, you then shift and you take on more iconic business leaders. And you know, the two that I want to raise and talk about are Walt Disney and Coco Chanel. Both clearly visionaries in different ways. But you know, you found some interesting things that you looked at them, and as you looked at them, you find they might not be the best lessons in leadership. And so talk a little bit about Walt Disney.
Walt Disney's story is fascinating. He's an animator in the 1920s, and he becomes extraordinarily innovative in doing these shorts. He creates Mickey Mouse, the first talking, cartoons. And he creates this talented group around him that's doing cutting edge animation, which were short movies or short films that were done before feature films. Then in 1934, he's got this team which is growing. He gives everybody in the company 50 cents and tells them to go out to dinner, then come back after dinner. And they come into an auditorium, kind of like this, and he gets on the stage, and for 3 hours, he alone acts out every part in a folktale that he says that they're going to make a movie of, and it's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. He personally acts out each dwarf. He personally acts out the Huntsman and Snow White. And he tells them that they're going to do the first full-length animated movie ever, which was a huge gamble because nobody thought an animated movie could be a full-length movie. And he says, we're going to make things that not only make people laugh, but make them cry. So he does this, and for 3 years they create it. And he's so meticulous that at one point, as they're working through trying to meet deadlines, one of the animators puts Dopey, you remember the last of the dwarfs, walking in, gives him a hitch step to get back in step. Walt Disney sees it and he says, every time Dopey enters a scene, I want him to do that. That cost him 6 months. They had to go back and redraw stuff. But he was that focused. Well, in 1937, it comes out and it's a huge hit. He's on the top of his game. People are feeling great about Disney. 4 years later, his animators strike against him, this bitter labor strike. And you think about it, how could that happen? How could you have the dichotomy there? They loved him, they wanted to be a part of it and all, but 4 years later they're striking because they don't think he gives them enough credit, doesn't take great care of them. And the reality was, he He's a tough leader to work for. He wasn't able to scale his leadership from that small group to a big corporation. And so as a consequence, what he basically did is step to the side, created Disneyland and other projects while his brother, Roy Disney, in fact, managed or ran.
Managed the company.
The company.
Yeah. Well, there are lots of stories. I mean, it's interesting that he went to Founders. I do want to go to Coco Chanel, but there are lots of examples of founders create, and they do incredibly to create, but operating and maintaining, shepherding, very, very different than creating.
Yeah.
Different kind of leadership.
And David loves Coco Chanel. You probably didn't know that about him. But when we started the book, I didn't know it was a person. And so, I just thought it was a brand, Chanel. Chanel number 5, you know, whatever. But Coco Chanel was this orphan who grows up in rural France, becomes a courtesan of a cavalry officer, but she's really clever and she sees this moment, and she has learned to sew. She sees this moment on the eve of World War I when fashions have to change. They're heavy, they're corseted, they're expensive, they're all these things. And she's this lithe, athletic young lady, and she says, people have got to work. Women have got to get in society in a new way. They want cheaper clothes. They want more flexible clothes. So she starts creating them. And it's wildly successful, but one of the reasons it is she becomes the brand. She acts the part. She wears the clothes. She has a lifestyle. She uses herself for marketing. And the selling point was, you should want to be like Coco Chanel. Be like me, therefore, buy my clothes, wear my perfume. Yet she was also this incredible business person. And by that, later in life, she'd be chain-smoking cigarettes, making female live young ladies stand there as human mannequins for hours while she adjusted fashions on them. And yet people still wanted to work for her because they were doing something special. It was Chanel. They had to line up each morning when she showed up at the store, almost like a little reviewing party, and she'd march on in, and then they all went in and did their thing. So she was almost dictatorial as a leader, and yet, again, she never had a problem attracting people.
Or attracted to her.
Yeah. They want to be part of it.
Yeah. You then go on, you talk about reformers, you talk about Martin Luther, you talk about Martin Luther King Jr., and you know, something you wrote here, you know, really resonated with me. You know, they each left an indelible mark as a leader, but we attribute too much to them as individuals, and we neglect the systems that ask them to lead. Talk a little bit about that.
That's great.
That really resonated with me in a very, very interesting way, particularly with Martin Luther King Jr.
Exactly. Yeah? And you think Martin Luther, the Protestant Reformation, and we think he nailed the 95 theses on the wall or on the door. And he may or may not have done that. History's pretty questionable on that. But the reality is there was this dissatisfaction with the Catholic Church. And this was at a period when you could buy indulgences. And that meant if you bought indulgences for you or your forebears, they would avoid going to purgatory. They would go on to heaven much faster. And you think about it, that's pretty transactional. And so he was rebelling against that. But he wasn't rebelling just himself. He was reflecting this dissatisfaction with what the Roman Catholic Church had become. And so he sort of got in front of the parade and led it. And then you compare him to Martin Luther King Jr., who joins the civil rights movement as a 26-year-old pastor in Montgomery, Alabama. And he, new to the city because he's from Alabama, he takes leadership of the Montgomery bus boycott in December of 1955. And this is right after, this is in the heels of Rosa Parks refusing to give up her seat, and that the civil rights movement made it their decision, their next campaign, to get rid of segregated public transportation in Montgomery, Alabama, which was a tall order. And so he is elected the leader of this thing for no good reason other than he's at the meeting that night and he probably didn't have any enemies in the community. And early in this process, you realize how hard it's gonna be because it means every African American to support the boycotts gotta walk to work, gotta carpool, gotta do something incredibly inconvenient every single day, twice a day, and they've gotta meet at least one night a week, and then they've got to endure a lot. His home is bombed early in the, with his infant daughter and wife inside, it's bombed. And yet they start this campaign and it lasts 382 days. and they navigated to success, and you say, wow, he could spike the football. Dr. King has done his thing in life, and any of us would be proud of it. He went for 12 more years leading the civil rights movement, never elected, never appointed, always informally having to pull together this community of people. He's jailed 12 times. And his leadership is much more than the rhetorical, I have a dream.
Sure.
His leadership is practical. And then he's murdered before the age of 40. And the most impressive thing to me about it, and he's the most impressive leader in the book to me, just effective leader. When he dies, the movement doesn't stop. They don't start dog paddling in circles, wondering what happened. Instead, he's created an organization, he's been part of one that has momentum.
Mm-hmm. And pushes forward. I want to go back to the battlefield for a second, but really just to kind of lead in and talk a little bit about geopolitics and what's sure. going on in the world today. And you know, it's been almost a decade since you launched your counterinsurgency strategy in Afghanistan. That fight there obviously continues. Taliban's still a force to be reckoned with. What's the end game there?
Yeah.
And you know, how does that play out in your mind?
Yeah, I think the end game there, of course, unless there's the end of the world, there's no end to it. So it's mm-hmm. going to evolve. I think what's going to happen is the Taliban's going to end up, there's going to be a negotiation.
Right.
The government and the Taliban are going to come sort of the middle, and there'll be a fractious nation of sorts. It won't be a, you know, wonderful democracy that loves everybody, but it will come together, because at the end of the day, they have to live there, and it's just not sustainable for them to have too strong Northern Alliance or the existing people and the Taliban not working together. But that can last quite a long time. You see how long some other insurgencies go. I think the United States needs and will stay involved, but not in a huge way, not thousands and thousands of troops. I don't think we should pull out precipitously. I think we should understand that this is an evolution. It's not a war to be won or to be lost. It's a situation to be managed as we go forward. And this is the case that's so hard for parents of young men and women sent to go. That's the way it's going to be, I think. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. The idea that we need to either go win and get out isn't reasonable. It's like having a six-year-old kid and say, I want him to be a good adult. You got 6 weeks to get your act together, go to college.
Doesn't work that way.
No.
Yeah. Last time you were here, we spoke a bunch about cyber.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think about from where I sit, and I've been asked, and I've said this, you know, what's the number one thing that I worry about? You know, I worry about the threat of cyber.
Yeah.
And I actually think it's interesting, because it's not understood well. Mm-hmm. And the imbalance between, you know, government knowledge, business knowledge in certain businesses, regulatory knowledge, I mean, it's all over the map in terms of what people really understand. How do you think, you know, both Washington and business should take on this threat?
Yeah.
And, you know, as we look forward, this is a serious issue that requires real nonpartisan cooperation.
Yeah.
What kind of advice do you have on an approach that can move us forward with this?
Yeah, first, I couldn't agree more. If you think of cyber now, think of bandwidth in Maslow's hierarchy. Your bandwidth is probably number one or two now. I mean, if we suddenly couldn't communicate using digital things, we wouldn't be frustrated because we couldn't text somebody. Our society would seize up, and it would seize up in a heartbeat, because so many things we have and do are dependent upon that. So there's no saying, well, we just go back 20 years and do it. The Rubicon's been passed on that one. Then you say, okay, what are the different parts of cyber? The cyber defense, which is sort of understood, but then the other things that cyber, because we communicate so effectively now, the ability to influence what the Russians did and what other people do all the time, from marketing to data collection. I lump that all in cyber now, because the ability to influence people to do or not to do something and whatnot is just, it's not even appreciated yet, just how powerful it is. We were talking before we came out here about the ability now to change video, doctor video, so that you can create something that looks completely real, but it's not. And yet, think about putting something like that out. Think what it could do to inflame passions and get people to do things. So we've got this kryptonite, which is cyber, and nobody has yet used it. And the most frightening, People have used it, but it hasn't been used as
on a mass scale.
Dangerously, yeah. And so I think that what we've got to do is we've got to think of it this way. And right now, a lot of mindsets are each firm or each individual gets sort of point defense. I'm going to protect my firm or my home or my identity. And it doesn't work in cyber that way. It's got to be layered, as you'll well know. And it's got to be very, very cross-compartmented in information sharing, because you can't be effective, each individual defending their own turf. And so I think the government's going to be far more involved in the future in cyber defense than in the past. It may take a huge event to push it faster.
Yeah, that's unfortunately, that's what I've always thought, that if you really want to push it and accelerate and get better cooperation, you know, country comes together when there's some sort of a catalyst, but you know, a catalyst could be very, very, very disruptive. So I want to go back to service, and you know, we've talked about this before. You've always had a very, you know, well articulated view that service is really important, and we should really be more of an advocate from a societal perspective to really encourage people to do some public service, you know, in their young years. And by the way, we're not talking about military service, we're talking about public service in general. Why is it so hard to get us here in the United States to be more open, you know, to that as a much more important part of development and our community all coming together?
I think it comes back to citizenship. If you think what citizen is, a citizen's a person who's part of a state or a nation. And it's God didn't create the United States. God didn't draw this border and say, this is the United States of America, you're Americans. People came together and made a decision to make a nation. And in doing that, they made citizens with a certain number of rights. You get the right to be defended. You get certain legal rights that we shaped. And you have responsibilities to take care of each other, protect, and whatnot. And I think what's happened to citizenship in America is it has eroded to the point where we think if we pay our taxes and we vote, we've checked the box. We're doing our citizenship thing. But in reality, citizenship is this organic interaction to make society work. And for a long time, it came second nature. You needed to raise barns, you needed to defend, you needed to do volunteer fire departments. You couldn't have a society without that sense of citizenship. In Afghanistan, they've got this underground irrigation system called Karezes, and they're these tunnels, and the whole community's got to go out once a year and dig, clean them out, or they get silted up, and then there's no irrigation and therefore no farming. So they all get together. It's community service. We've outsourced a lot of our community service now. We have our police and firemen as professionals in so many cases that we're now thinking that, well, we've just paid for everything. And so the idea of service has been reduced. And the fact that we haven't had a World War II recently or something that causes so many people to come in and serve so overtly, I think has added to that. And then we know people should be committed to the greater good. And you say, well, okay, everybody should do something. Then someone says, well, everyone should volunteer. Well, that's hard to do. I mean, they have a lot of time. Most people have pretty hard jobs and kids and whatnot. Yet I think everyone needs an experience. Many of you have had military service or some other service, and you left that experience different. Statistically, if you did service like the Peace Corps, AmeriCorps, City Year, you vote at 3 times the rate of your peers. You participate more. So what we've been pushing, and Jay Mangone and I worked on it for a long time together, is the idea of voluntary but expected national service for young people. A year of paid service for everyone in conservation, healthcare, education, whatever you want to do, with the idea that you do it with people not from your zip code. You do it in something that you might never do again, but you'll feel differently about society because you're invested in it. And you walk away with that experience. And I think that it has to be paid, or only, you know, the children of well-to-do can afford to do it. So you got to give everybody that opportunity. And every time I talk about it in groups of almost every age, there's extraordinary support for it.
Right.
But then when you say, well, let's do it, and I talk to politicians all the time. Our biggest supporter was John McCain, and we hated losing him. But every time you say, okay, let's do this, let's make it happen, then you get people starting to look at the floor and saying, well, you know, we'll kind of wait and see what happens. I think America's scared to do anything big anymore. I think we're like a deer in the headlights. You know, we stay up there and you look at something, you go, wow, that's expensive, that's hard, I don't know, boom, boom, boom. The reality is, if we're going to do anything big in America, we're going to do it. Nobody else can do it. And so why can't we just decide to do it? Why can't we say we'd be a better country if we did it? And then we can argue about the how. It's easy to argue about the little pieces of it. But I believe we'd be fundamentally different and fundamentally healthier for it.
So just to wrap up, a couple of lightning round quick questions. Leader you most admire?
Probably Martin Luther King Jr.
If you could meet anyone in history, go have a sit down with anyone in history, who would it be?
Yeah. This is very myopic. It's John Buford, a Union cavalry general from the Battle of Gettysburg.
Wow.
Only because...
That is.
Yeah. He made the decision to commit the Army of the Potomac at the Battle of Gettysburg, even though he was a one-star general, and he didn't have the authority, but he made the decision to commit the whole army. And then 6 months later, he died basically of exhaustion. And he was a professional soldier who was a Southerner but decided to stay with the North. And he's just been somebody I've always admired and been fascinated by, and I just love to talk to him about that decision.
That decision, yeah.
That's 37 really, that's years really old when he did it. It was amazing.
Really, really interesting. And then last, best piece of advice you've ever received?
Wow. Yeah, you know, my father was a soldier, and I remember I was just about to graduate from West Point. And I said, Dad, you know, I'm about to go out and you've been successful in your career. What would you do differently? And he said, I wouldn't work so hard. And I said, it's easy for you to say you made it, you know. And I didn't follow his advice, I'll be first to tell you. But it was the best advice I've ever gotten. I don't regret many things I've done in my life, but I regret a whole bunch of things I didn't do. I regret family reunions I didn't go to. I regret weddings I didn't go to. I regret friends I didn't go visit. I regret those things. And so that's the advice I wish.
A lot of it, though, in a life of service, where you were putting others before you. And so we're thankful for that.
Well, you're
and
kind of that,
always great to see you. Yeah, and really appreciate you being here.
Thanks
a lot, Stan.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you.